Hey there once again, YouTube. My name is Ben Ferraiuolo. First off, I just want to say that in the future, I might not be able to do these updates anymore due to lack of time. In the coming months and years, I'm going to be much busier than I am right now, so these monthly updates might be cut in half or not even done at all. However, just know I will try my best to find time to do these monthly updates. Now, this video is extremely long, so please skip to a part that interests you by utilizing the parts section shown in the description box directly below. The parts section shows the volcanoes and the aspects that I talk about for each section, allowing you to skip to a volcano that you want to hear about. Please like, share, and subscribe if you like my work, and also please visit my website. It contains a great deal of information. It can show you how to find seismic data, GPS data as well, how to analyze it, with what programs to analyze it with, and much more. It even shows you earthquake examples and over 1,000 seismic plots generated by yours truly, pertaining to many different earthquake swarms and events. There's also a link in the description box below, right under my email address. It's a great resource, so go check it out. This is the monthly volcano report for May 2019. The reported earthquake counts I state are taken directly from the United States Geological Survey, USGS, and their partners, and are only earthquakes reported, not earthquakes recorded. Regarding earthquake counts, it is likely a lot of the time that the reported earthquake total for a given location and time period, mostly during earthquake swarms, is lower than the actual count of earthquakes, in some cases, drastically lower. Now, this has to do with a multitude of factors, including inability to locate, lack of a nice seismic array, and other reasons. Sometimes it makes sense, and sometimes it doesn't. It is my goal somewhere down the line to major in seismology and also study volcanology. But I do believe that I am properly equipped right now to give you guys a heads up if anything concerning may occur at volcanoes throughout the United States. Remember, most earthquake swarms of volcanoes do not lead to eruptions, but almost every eruption is preceded by some type of earthquake swarm and surface deformation. Therefore, swarms and deformations should always be monitored closely regardless of where you think the activity is headed. The volcanoes I'll be doing monthly and yearly updates on will be Yellowstone Supervolcano in Wyoming, Long Valley Supervolcano in California, Newberry Caldera and Mount Hood in Oregon, Mount Rainier and Mount St. Helens in Washington State, and Mount Shasta and Lassen Peak in California. Also, don't forget to check out the NW Geology Guys channel and the other YouTube channel called Morning Dew, D-E-W. Now, links to both the channels are in the description box below. I talk to them a lot, and they seem to have some good information, and they are learning, just like all of us. So check out their channels if you want, and show your support if you wish. In this update, we will look at earthquake counts and uplift subsidence patterns. The time period of the reported earthquake counts for this video, derived from the USGS earthquake catalog, is from 0 UTC, May 1st, 2019, through 2359 UTC, May 31st, 2019, and magnitudes are always going to be negative 1.0 and above, so you will see every single earthquake that was reported for this time period. Yes, earthquakes can occur at negative magnitudes, the smallest ever being a 1.0, but require sensitive seismographs to accurately locate. Thank God a lot of the seismic instruments being activated these days are sensitive enough for such recordings. Also, the coordinate box that I use for each volcano is exactly the same every month, so you will always see the activity that occurred in the same area every month. Every month's update will be uploaded about 5 days or so after the month in question has ended. Also, in regards to the three plot seismic images I generate for the largest events, I will always try my best to use the closest seismic station to any given event. As always, let's start with Yellowstone Supervolcano in Wyoming. Here we are at Yellowstone National Park and Caldera, a supervolcano that resides in northwest Wyoming. There were 86 earthquake events reported for the Yellowstone area for the month of May 2019. Yellowstone Volcano Observatory is saying 77, but that might be because my coordinate box is a little bit, just barely larger than the one that they have. Now, this month's total is a little bit larger than last month's total, which was around 58 earthquakes. During this month, there were multiple minor rapid-fire swarms around Yellowstone Caldera, primarily around West Thumb Lake and Yellowstone Lake. You can find details to most of the minor rapid-fire swarms that occurred around West Thumb and Yellowstone Lake, Yellowstone Caldera, on my website, on my Yellowstone Supervolcano page. You can see I have multiple posts here about them in the month of May. Multiple minor rapid-fire swarms. Just go to my website, go to Seismic Events, go to By Location, and press Yellowstone Supervolcano, and check out the posts here if you wish. So we see here there were indeed some minor swarms within the caldera boundary. The thing that is interesting is that most of these swarms saw only a minute percentage of earthquakes reported. maybe only 5 to 10% of the actual count of earthquakes for each swarm. But I do have to say, a lot of the earthquakes within the swarms were very, 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 very small. Some earthquakes, again, obviously cannot be located because many were extremely small. However, many did appear on multiple surrounding stations with clear PNS wave arrivals. So I'm a little puzzled as to why the reported count was so low for these earthquake swarms, especially the minor swarm at West Thumb Lake on May 28, 2019. So this means that the reported earthquake count for this month, which rests at 86 for my coordinate box, is much lower than the actual number of earthquakes. During the month of May 2019, Steamboat Geyser in the Norris Geyser Basin erupted a total of 5 times, erupting almost perfectly once per week. The last eruption of May was officially the 50th eruption since it reactivated in early 2018. Remember, I do keep a very detailed page called Steamboat Geyser 2019. Again, just come to my website, go to Seismic Events, go to Buy Event, and click Steamboat Geyser 2019 to see all of the current eruptions in 2019. And I do try to update it once an eruption happens as quick as I can. And for all the eruptions of 2018, you can click Steamboat 2018 right there. But we do see there were multiple eruptions. Here is the 19th eruption, which occurred on June 2nd. Just a day or two ago. But then again, it did erupt 5 times in May, almost perfectly once per week, except the eruption most recently on June 2nd was about 1.5 days early. So I thought that was very intriguing. Here's the 18th eruption, which occurred on May 27, 2019. Here's the 17th eruption, which occurred on May 20th, 2019. Going down. Here's the 16th eruption, which occurred on May 14th, 2019. There it is right there. It also appeared on YNR, like a lot of the eruptions are now starting to show on YNR. Here's the 15th eruption of 2019, which occurred on May 8th. And going down, let's see, I think that's the last one. Nope, on May 3rd. On May 3rd, we did see another eruption as well. So, very interesting, guys. 5 times during the month of May. For the Yellowstone Supervolcanic Complex, the largest earthquakes to occur within the month of May 2019 were 2 magnitude 2.5 earthquakes, as you can see right here. Now let's see, one in West Yellowstone on May 7th at 7.7 kilometers in depth, and one struck the northern tip of Yellowstone Lake on May 23rd at 4.9 kilometers in depth. Now since there are 2 events, let's just use the most recent, which was the one that struck the northern tip of Yellowstone Lake, just up to the north right here. This actually was part of the May 23rd, 2019 earthquake swarm in that same location. And by the way, I did make a post about this earthquake swarm on my Yellowstone Supervolcano blog, which I already showed you how to get to. And all the way down here, let's scroll all the way down to the slideshow just real quick. And here we see the magnitude 2.5 at 4.9 kilometers in depth, which was the second of 2 of the largest events for the coordinate box that I created for Yellowstone within the month of May. There seems to have been maybe 10 or so earthquakes during this swarm around this same size, somewhat, maybe down to 1.5 or so. However, there were many, many other very tiny events that did occur as part of this earthquake swarm as well. Alright, so you can tell that I am not on volcanoes.usgs.gov like I used to do. I will leave a link to this new website below. It's not new, I didn't use it in my most recent update right before this one, but I just somewhat recently discovered it, and this is the second monthly update again where I have used this. And this map was made by the Geodetic Laboratory of the University of Nevada, Reno. It's a very good tool to use. It will show you all-time GPS deformation plots for every single GPS station on the face of our blue planet. No joke, guys. Just in this one location, notice how many stations there are, but if you zoom out to the world, it's pretty crazy. It almost makes your computer freeze how many stations there are. Now, the reason I use this is because most of the GPS plots on volcanoes.usgs.gov, at least from what I could see, did not take into account the motion of the North American plate, especially for these stations down in Long Valley. Any station on the North American plate has an extra reference frame called NA12. Even some locations that are not on the North American plate, such as Hawaii, uses NA12 to remove the natural motion of the plates to see actual activity caused by other processes not connected to normal plate movement. Because I did not select NA12 in the past, my projections of horizontal deformation for Long Valley Caldera were wrong. Not too wrong, but I would rather be as accurate as I can be. Usually plate motion rarely affects vertical deformation, uplift or subsidence, but it surely affects how horizontal deformation is shown. Now, let's real quick zoom into Yellowstone, right down here, and let's start with LKWY, right on the northern tip of Yellowstone Lake. Yep, you can see LKWY. Let's start with this real quick. Now, when viewing these deformation plots, remember east shows east-west horizontal deformation. Deformation means the way the ground shifts over a long period of time. North means north-south horizontal deformation, and vertical obviously shows uplift or subsidence, whether the ground is swelling or deflating. Sadly, LKWY is no longer sampling data right now, and I think the seismic and GPS co-located stations are offline and have been for a while. May and June is a time where scientists are in the park, so hopefully they fix LKWY soon, among many other stations like YPP and YMS that do need to be fixed terribly bad. But you can see here, the past 2 decades saw 2 episodes of substantial caldera uplift, especially between 2004-2006. A lot of swelling in a very short period of time right here. But right when the first uplift episode began, note that the ground started to shift towards the south at about the same time between 2004 and 2006. Remember, measurements here are in millimeters. Reading plot or chart labels first before reading the data is paramount if you wish to understand it. Note the east-west chart didn't show too much of a change since then. It almost seems like uplift at the Sour Creek Dome is also coupled with southward deformation. You notice that? And the second round of uplift that we saw starting at about, 2014, seems to dip down to the south once again. So that's very, very interesting. LKWY resides right on the southern section of the Sour Creek Resurgent Dome. But let's move on to another one, which resides on the Mallard Lake Resurgent Dome near the Upper Geyser Basin near where Old Faithful resides. Alright, here are the GPS deformation plots for the Upper Geyser Basin near where Old Faithful resides, right on top of the Mallard Lake Resurgent Dome. Although there is a slight change in the horizontal components, notice that, it is not even close to as great as the one that we saw in LKWY. However, we see the past 2 periods of uplift occurred here as well. There's a little bit of a smaller time range than LKWY. But you can see there was a little bit of horizontal, going to the west. And barely any change at all in the north-south. So during the uplift episodes, the Mallard Lake Resurgent Dome swelled, just like the other Resurgent Dome. But it headed to the west. Very, very, very intriguing. Don't know why that would be. But again, we see the past 2 periods of swelling at Yellowstone Caldera here as well. Something that I don't like about these plots is the inability to shift the time range to a range that you want. Do not fret, guys, I found a way. Let's take a look at recent deformation from January 1st, 2018. So almost a year and a half worth of GPS data via a custom scatter plot. Now here's a custom scatter plot on Microsoft Excel showing vertical deformation, uplift or subsidence for OFW2, which resides on the top of the Mallard Lake Resurgent Dome near the Upper Geyser Basin. This GPS data was gathered from UNR in a 12 reference frame via the UNAVCO web service. The beginning of the scatter plot is January 1st, 2018, and the last dot all the way at the end is May 25th, 2019. Sadly, OFW2 seems to be taken offline since the 25th. It is fieldwork month. So I think they might be replacing it, hopefully. One sample is taken once per day. Overall subsidence seems to be occurring. But around late July 2018, which is right here at the 200 mark, there seems to have been a small but quick spurt in uplift. Notice that? Just very, very, very quick. Interesting, that's also the time that we saw the major rapid fire swarm, the July 5th, 2018 event at West Thumb Lake. Do not know if this slight spurt in uplift is connected to that major rapid fire swarm or not, but it is interesting to note that there was a connection, at least in my opinion. Now, it pretty much has been subsiding ever since July, August of 2018. The last couple weeks of data almost looks like a very small amount of uplift could be occurring again, but it's way, way too early to tell. We will check this out in next month's update if I'm able to get the update out for you guys. Each section, from line to line, is a total of 20 millimeters, in other words, 2 centimeters. And here are the deformation plots for WLWY, which resides just a few miles northeast of LKWY at Yellowstone Lake. WLWY is also on the eastern edge of the Sour Creek Resurgent Dome. Remember, the top two are horizontal, and the bottom plot all the way down here shows uplift and subsidence. Note, we see the same sort of uplift patterns that we did on all the other stations within Yellowstone Caldera. But let's take a closer look at recent uplift subsidence patterns for this station. Alright, here's my custom GPS vertical deformation scatter plot on Microsoft Excel showing uplift subsidence patterns since January 1st, 2018 at the beginning, and the last sample all the way at the end, the last dot, is May 29th, 2019. Again, data was taken from UNR via the UNAVCO web service and A12 reference frame, so the motion of the North American plate is removed. Note that we see the same trend of ongoing subsidence that we're seeing on all stations across Yellowstone Caldera. However, right around the 1:30 mark, right about here, which would be about mid-May 2018, almost June 2018, it looks like there was a slight spurt in uplift. Now, it stalled, notice how it stalled, just for, I'm going to say, a few months or so, and subsidence has basically been occurring ever since. However, the past few weeks, looking at the data at the end of the plot, it looks like subsidence has stopped and uplift is starting to occur. Do not take my word for it, though. Again, it is still far, far too early to say whether or not a real uplift episode is beginning or not, and this amount of uplift is very, very small. Very small. But recent data does look very intriguing. Each section, from line to line, is a total of 10 millimeters, in other words, 1 centimeter. And here is NRWY in the Norris Geyser Basin, near where Steamboat Geyser resides. Norris does see a different uplift subsidence pattern than other stations within the caldera boundary at Yellowstone. Some are theorized to be caused by an intrusion of magma in the early 2000s, and other theories put hydrothermal fluids and brine as a possible culprit. Overall, any fluid-caused uplift or earthquakes usually has deep origins in the magma system itself. After all, that's where it gets all its heat from, guys. Sometimes fluids can escape from magma, though, and attempt to make its way to the surface. However, in the case of 2014, my personal theory, my opinion, was that uplift was caused by a small intrusion of magma at Norris. Note you see the spike here that shows uplift occurred very, very quickly. Coincidentally, this is also the same time that Yellowstone saw its largest earthquake since 1998, possibly even prior to that. This is my earthquake statistics page, all 5 pages in the quake statistics drop-down menu, got a serious makeover a month or so ago. I completely redid all of the pages and they now contain much more accurate information and now show a whole slew of plots and charts. The quake statistics menu is located under the more drop-down menu on my website. So, after the quick spurt and uplift right here, very extreme, very, very fast. I mean, you can see it's almost vertical, guys. Look at that. Almost a right angle. I mean, that's very, very fast uplift. Ever since then, subsidence continued until about 2016. It has been rising ever since. However, just recently, as in the past 6 months or so, uplift has stalled. So let's take a closer look at the GPS data for NRWY and Norris, just to see where the uplift subsidence pattern is headed. Here's the custom GPS data from UNR, reference frame NA12 for station NRWY at Norris. The beginning of the plot is January 1st, 2018, and the last sample taken, the last dot all the way at the end, is May 29th, 2019. We can see overall slight uplift has been occurring, except for the past few months or so. First off, there was a dip in subsidence right around early July 2018, then uplift started again and stalled right around mid-January 2019 of this year. The most recent data for the past few months suggests that subsidence could be starting for the Norris area. This would be interesting if uplift is starting to occur within the caldera, then subsidence could be starting here. I'm not saying that's what's happening, but I'm just saying that would be very interesting if that's what happened. It almost switched, right? Because subsidence has been occurring for a while along the caldera, uplift has been occurring a while in Norris. But if they both switch at the same time, that's got to show that there's some type of correlation. I don't know if that's a fact. It's going to take a while to see if that's true or not. But that would be very, very intriguing to see if that was true. Now, with all the other stations around Yellowstone that have been showing a recent change, again, it is still too early to tell. Each section, from line to line, is a total of 10 millimeters, in other words, 1 centimeter. Now, we'll continue to keep an eye on these stations, but let's move on to the next volcano, or should I say supervolcano, called Long Valley Caldera, which resides just east of Yosemite, right on the slopes of the Sierra Nevada Range. Here we are at the Long Valley Caldera Supervolcanic Complex. According to USGS, Long Valley Caldera in eastern California is the center of continuing volcanic activity and moderate earthquakes. Non-eruptive volcanic activity, but volcanic nonetheless. Also, it is interesting to note from around 1980 through 2014, the caldera had risen over 2.5 feet after being almost nearly silent for a great amount of time. That is an impressive amount of uplift for that time period. Long Valley experienced a very concerning period of heightened volcanic unrest back in the 80s and 90s. Uplift still continues at the caldera today with some periods of short-lived subsidence, but it is possible it is currently charging for the next super eruption. Don't know when that'll be, but it certainly is. The most intense of these swarms began in May 1980, the same month and year as the Mount St. Helens eruptions. Isn't that interesting? And included four strong magnitude 6 shocks, three on the same day. Following these earthquakes, scientists from USGS began a re-examination of the Long Valley area, and they soon detected other evidence of unrest, a dome-like uplift within the caldera. Measurements showed that the center of the caldera had risen almost a foot, 30 centimeters, since about the summer of 1979. After decades of stability, this swelling, which totaled 2.5 feet by 2014 and affected more than 100 square miles, is caused by new magma rising beneath the caldera. And according to researchers, there is approximately 240 cubic miles of magma at a shallow depth right under the caldera. Long Valley currently houses enough magma to suction if it erupted at full potential today. Although there is no sign of that in the short term, the unrest in the 80s and 90s, which included large uplifts, seismicity, and tree kill events caused by degassing, taught us that this volcano could be nearing a super eruption. Calderas can see increased volcanic unrest for decades before actually erupting. However, if an intrusion event were to occur that would lead to a super eruption, it could take only weeks or months for the super eruption to occur. In my opinion, Long Valley Caldera is the most restless volcano in the continental United States, not counting Mount St. Helens. Interesting to note that the unrest at Long Valley was getting severe around May 1980, the same year as the Mount St. Helens eruption. A coincidence? You be the judge. You know, people are always worried about a super eruption at Yellowstone, and maybe rightfully so in some cases. However, people never pay attention to Long Valley, which is much closer to a super eruption than Yellowstone is. There were 323 earthquake events reported for the Long Valley Caldera area for the month of May 2019. Let me turn on terrain just real quick. As usual, we see most of the seismicity being centered along the southern half of the caldera right here, with many earthquakes strung farther to the south and to the southeast. This month's seismicity is just barely smaller than last month's seismicity. The largest event to occur within the boundary of the coordinate box I used, was a magnitude 3.0 near Round Valley, California on May 1st, 2019 at 1741 UTC, striking at 14 kilometers in depth. Many earthquakes have been occurring there, in my opinion, because of local tectonic activity. But for the plots, I always like to use the largest event closest to the caldera itself, so we will use this one right here. It was a magnitude 2.3 at 8.1 kilometers in depth, just barely south of the southern caldera boundary. It occurred on May 9, 2019 at 1650 UTC. For your convenience, here are the seismogram, spectrogram, and spectra plots to the magnitude 2.3 at 8.1 kilometers in depth on May 9, 2019. We see it looks like a normal high range frequencies, as you can see. Some stronger and lower frequencies, but it's a normal high-frequency VT, volcano tectonic earthquake, which occurs as part of the normal background seismicity at volcanoes worldwide. Here we have the deformation plot for RDOM at Long Valley Caldera, which resides right on top of the resurgent dome within the caldera itself. I really want to sincerely apologize to everyone that I was wrong about one thing in previous updates, not counting the most recent update for April. The April update is where I announced my mistake regarding Long Valley Caldera. Now, I was wrong that Long Valley was headed to the southwest. I forgot to remove the motion of the North American plate, and once I did that, as you can see here by using the NA12 reference frame, the ground is actually moving to the northwest, not the southwest. Notice it's moving north and moving west. I apologize for that, and that just goes to show you that understanding the plots you read is huge when trying to understand what is occurring. Also, you can see ongoing uplift of the resurgent dome since this station was installed in 1999. We see subsidence was occurring until about 2002, right here, where there was another spike in uplift. And then over the next few years, really neither uplift or subsidence was occurring at all. But right around late 2011, right around here, boom, we see a large spike in uplift that has pretty much been ongoing since. You can tell the uplift is not seasonal at all, so that means it is likely renewed uplift is being caused by new magma filling the reservoir, or the chamber itself is slowly rising to the surface, but it's more than magma is filling the reservoir, much more magma. Now, why don't we take a look at uplift subsidence patterns for the same station, but instead from January 1st, 2018 through May 29th, 2019. Here's the vertical GPS data for station RDOM, which resides on the top of the resurgent dome in Long Valley Caldera. This shows uplift or subsidence. Data was obtained from UNR via the UNAVCO web service reference frame NA12. The start of this scatter plot is January 1st, 2018, and the last sample taken, the last dot all the way at the end, is June 1st, 2019. We see uplift continued at a constant rate, but right around late 2018 or so, last year, uplift stopped and leveled out for a little while. Then we see subsidence occurred, and the most recent data suggests uplift possibly, very possibly, could be starting again. Now, sometimes subsidence does occur in Long Valley, but it is usually pretty short-lived. The norm since 2011 is uplift. Each section you see here, from line to line, is a total of 10 millimeters, in other words, 1 centimeter. Now, this is the GPS station which resides on the northeastern slopes of Mammoth Mountain between the base and the summit. Mammoth Mountain is located on the southwestern rim of Long Valley Caldera. Again, you can find the locations to all of these stations and more if you look at the links in the description box below and go to the UNR map. Contrary to popular belief, it is actually thought that Mammoth Mountain's magma chamber is completely separate from Long Valley's. However, Long Valley's magma system contains much more magma and is in close proximity to Mammoth Mountain's magma system. I wouldn't be surprised if one day Long Valley's magma system takes over the one under Mammoth, if indeed it does have a separate system. For the north and east horizontal components, you can tell something weird happened right when this station was installed, I'm going to say right in 1999 or so. This is obviously a glitch. However, you can sort of tell which way the station is heading, just like the other stations in the area, to the northwest. Notice that? West, north. Note the vertical component at the bottom. It is actually showing overall continued subsidence almost constantly since the station began recording deformation in 1999. The uplift in this area is occurring at Long Valley, not Mammoth Mountain. And, you know, I really don't see any type of uplift occurring much at Mammoth Mountain ever. Maybe here and there, but there seems to have been a quick bump here in 2011-2012. Notice that quick bump, just a little boop. And very, very slight uplift, but ever since then, subsidence has been occurring. But that's pretty much it for the Long Valley area. Now let's move on to Newberry Caldera in Central Oregon. Alright, now we here have the Newberry Caldera volcano, which resides in Central Oregon, just south of the city of Bend and east of the city of Lapine. It is a shield volcano with enormous volume and still considered to be very active. According to the University of Oregon, there are still several features that suggest that there's still magma beneath Newberry Volcano. First, there are hot springs around both Paulina Lake and East Lake. At times, the hot springs are too hot to bathe in and must be mixed with the cold lake water to be comfortable. Secondly, drilling at the center of the caldera found temperatures of 540 degrees Fahrenheit at about 3,000 feet below the caldera floor, the highest temperature ever recorded at a Cascade volcano. Wow, even hotter than Mount St. Helens? Woo! Also, here's the Newberry Earthquake Statistics page, which I've completely redone from head to toe. I also have yearly quake statistics of data from 1998 through 2018, including many GPS plots and seismic plots as well, not just for Newberry, but Mount Rainier, Yellowstone, Long Valley, and even the Cascadia Subduction Zone. Simply go to my website. Again, a link is under my email address in the description box below. Go to the Earthquake Statistics menu under the More drop-down menu and select the Volcano or the Cascadia Subduction Zone, whatever you want. Only one earthquake was reported during the month of May 2018 for Newberry Caldera, lower than April's total of 6 earthquakes. And you can see the one earthquake located just right here. Keep in mind that a good portion of seismicity the past few years at Newberry have been low-frequency earthquakes. Even the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network has labeled many of the earthquakes in the Newberry area lately as low-frequency earthquakes on their catalog. Some were removed that were not quarry blasts, so I don't know why they were removed from the catalog. But nevertheless, there have been a good amount of low-frequency earthquakes at Newberry. Of course, however, high-frequency earthquakes still occur. I believe the presence of low-frequency earthquakes at Newberry, seeing they are small and usually occur by themselves or in pairs, is caused by very small degassing from the magma reservoir or hydrothermal activity. Low-frequency earthquakes should always be monitored closely because they usually are not too concerning seeing them when they're really this rare. But if they ever do occur in swarms, that is what we need to watch out for. The largest and only earthquake reported for Newberry during May 2019 was a magnitude 0.9 high-frequency earthquake at 1.7 kilometers in depth, which struck northeast of the caldera rim, as you can see right here, on May 15, 2019 at 1210 UTC. And for your convenience, here are the seismogram, spectrogram, and spectra plots detailing the largest and only reported earthquake for Newberry Caldera during the month of May 2019, just to the northeast of the caldera rim. We see this was a normal high-frequency earthquake, and to the best of my knowledge, there have been no low-frequency earthquakes during the month of May 2019. Again, high-range frequencies, normal volcano tectonic earthquake. I mean, it wasn't right under the volcano itself, but it was just northeast of the caldera rim. Now here is GPS station CPCO, which is co-located with seismic station CPCO, right in the center of Newberry Caldera. We can see the east-west horizontal chart barely shows any changes at all. The north-south horizontal component shows the ground is slowly and slightly moving towards the north. Remember, the motion of the North American plate is removed here if you use this reference frame NA12. And the vertical plot at the bottom showing uplift or subsidence is showing overall slight subsidence of the caldera, just barely. If you have already been watching this video, you know what these yearly fluctuations are. Notice these patterns right here, and they coincide with seasons. These are seasonal changes which are recorded in volcanic areas and non-volcanic areas alike, meaning it is a sort of background noise, kind of like the background noise recorded by seismometers, but on a much longer and much bigger scale. However, these fluctuations should never be very large. This station seems to be down right now, and other GPS stations for the rest of the volcanoes aren't aren't showing much. So I won't be showing any more deformation for the following volcanoes to save on time. If you wish to see deformation for any of the following volcanoes, simply go to the UNR map, a link is provided below. Now let's move on to Mount Rainier. Now here we are at one of the most infamous Pacific Northwest volcanoes, Mount Rainier, which has a beautiful but potentially deadly backdrop to the Seattle skyline. There have been 18 reported earthquake events for the Mount Rainier area during the month of May 2019, breaking the pattern of monthly diminishing seismic activity. Let me turn on terrain real quick. Only a few occurred under Mount Rainier itself, with many striking to the southwest and to the west all along the West Rainier seismic zone. The largest earthquakes to strike the Mount Rainier area during the month of May were two magnitude 1.4 events, one right here and one right there, striking near the same depth and the same location within about an hour of each other on May 23rd. For the plots, I always like to use the largest event actually under Mount Rainier itself. So that would be, let's scroll all the way down, that would be, let's see, yep, that would be this one right here. This was a magnitude 1.3 earthquake at 1 kilometer in depth on May 7, 2019 at 10:04 UTC. For your convenience, here are the seismogram, spectrogram, spectra plots for the largest earthquake to occur under the Mount Rainier stratovolcano itself within the month of May 2019. Now, we do notice this, there are some strong lower frequencies. Look at the spectra plot between about 2 hertz and 8 hertz. Now, this is not a low frequency earthquake. This still could be considered a high frequency volcano tectonic earthquake, but it does have some stronger lower frequencies. But again, this is the largest for the month of May. Now here we are at the volcano that gave my mother a very bad day on May 18th, 1980, Mount St. Helens. This volcano pummeled my mother's house with inches of ash and even rained ash on my dad's car in Denver, Colorado. The main Mount St. Helens eruption ejected 0.29 cubic miles of ash, compared to the possible 240 cubic miles Long Valley Caldera might eject at the maximum during its next super eruption. For the month of May 2019, there were only 9 earthquakes reported for Mount St. Helens, which is less than last month's total, and even far lower than the month before that. Most of the seismicity, here let me turn on terrain real quick, most of the seismicity occurred in the northern section of the Mount St. Helens volcanic area, with only 2 occurring under the volcano itself. The largest reported earthquake for the month of May 2019 was a magnitude 1.1 at 8.8 kilometers in depth, just to the northeast, right over here. On May 18th, 2019 at 4:57 UTC. May 18th, 2019 was also the 39th anniversary of the Mount St. Helens 1980 eruption. Here we are in the seismic program, swarm with data from borehole 202 in the PB network, no location code given, short period vertical. We see two earthquakes right here. This earthquake right here was the reported, what was it again? Reported 1.1 at 8.8 kilometers in depth, just to the northeast of Mount St. Helens. We see this is it right here. There it is right there. Let's check out the frequencies. Normal high range frequencies, normal volcano tectonic event. Going right here, we do see an unreported earthquake. I already checked the catalog. This is unreported. According to the PNS wave arrivals, it does seem like it occurred primarily near the same location, and look at the amplitudes. I'm going to say it was probably actually, let's see, 400. I'm going to say maybe around the same size, maybe a 1.2, possibly at the same depth, but that's it right there. And again, here is the reported event. The other one I just showed was unreported. This was the 1.1, which was the largest reported event for the month of May. Here we are at the Mount Hood Stratovolcano in northern Oregon, which straddles the border between Washington and Oregon. Before I start, I just want to state that a new fault line of sorts has been discovered cutting through Mount Hood. A link will be posted below in the description box under resources. However, I think it'll probably be near the end of the resources list. They think that this newly discovered fault could trigger a magnitude 7.2 earthquake at best. This is pretty crazy for any stratovolcano. For the month of May 2019, there were very, very surprisingly 6 reported earthquakes. Very interesting. All being larger than magnitude 0.9. Very intriguing. I think this is possibly the highest count for Mount Hood that we have ever seen in any of my monthly updates. I haven't checked all my other updates, but I believe that's the case since I only ever see 1 or 2 earthquakes reported here for each month. Having terrain turned on, you can see there's one right here and another right here, so 2 occurred under Mount Hood itself, with 4 occurring right under the southern portion of Mount Hood's base. This is very, very intriguing, guys. The largest earthquake to strike this area for the month of May 2019 was a magnitude 1.6 earthquake just under the southern base at 1.8 kilometers in depth on May 25th, 2018 at 2:56 UTC. Now here we are in the seismic program swarm. During this day, which had the largest event of May, there were 2 other reported events for this same day that we're going to look at as well, but there were also a few other microquakes that were not reported, so let's take a very quick look at these earthquakes. No low-frequency harmonic or volcanic tremor was detected at all, and all events contained high-range frequencies indicative of normal volcano tectonic earthquakes. Could Mount Hood be very slowly waking up, or is this related to the major fault that they recently discovered? Regardless, let's just take a very, very quick look. Now, there were, let's see... Okay, on the 25th, they have 3 reported events, including the largest one. One occurred at 0059 UTC, 256 UTC, and 811 UTC. The earthquake at 0059 UTC, which was reportedly a magnitude 1.1. The next one was 1.6, which was the largest, and the next one was a 1.4. So this one right here was a magnitude 1.1 right here. And then we see directly after this earthquake, there was a very, very tiny, minor aftershock. You can tell that is definitely an earthquake, but very, very, very teeny tiny. Next one occurred at 256 UTC, which was this one right here, which was the largest event of May 2019, reportedly a magnitude 1.6 right there. And then the last reported one for this day was right here. Let me zoom down just real quick. Let's see what time was it at. 8:11 UTC. And we see at 8:11 UTC, we have this magnitude 1.4 right here. But there are 2 other earthquakes that were not reported that I did find, including this one right here. You can blatantly tell this is another volcano tectonic earthquake at Mount Hood during this day. And then we do see another earthquake right here. Right here. Now, I believe for it to be considered an earthquake swarm, it has to be 5 earthquakes or more within, I believe, a 12-hour period or a 24-hour period, I believe. So this cannot really be considered an earthquake swarm. I mean, these events are very tiny, but it almost was. It almost was considered an earthquake swarm. Again, here are the 2 unreported events that were not reported, right there. And the largest event of May for Mount Hood was this one right here, magnitude 1.6. Very, very interesting, guys. Very, very intriguing. Now, here's Mount Shasta, which resides just south of the California-Oregon border. If you have ever driven from southern Oregon into California using Interstate 5, you already know that the volcano is very large. In my opinion, Mount Shasta is California's version of Oregon's Mount Hood, especially in regards to this month's seismicity. This month pretty much confirms that, guys. Usually both Shasta and Hood only see one or two earthquakes per month. However, this month, both volcanoes saw 6 reported events, which is higher than what we usually see. So both Shasta and Hood saw an increase in seismicity, and both saw the same amount of reported earthquakes, even though they're in different networks. Very, very interesting. So, for Mount Shasta, in May 2019, we saw 6 earthquakes reported for Mount Shasta. Only one occurred actually under the volcano itself, with the rest spread out to the southeast, and one even farther to the southeast, right down here. The largest earthquake reported for Mount Shasta during May was a magnitude 1.6, which was the farthest earthquake to the southeast, at 6.2 kilometers in depth on May 19, 2019, at 1402 UTC. However, for the following plots, I would like to use this earthquake right here, right under the volcano itself. It was a magnitude 1.3 earthquake at negative 0.5 kilometers in depth, which is 0.5 kilometers above sea level, but still within the volcano edifice. It struck on May 3rd, 2019 at 1440 UTC. For your convenience here, the seismogram, spectrogram, spectra plots of the largest and only earthquake to strike under Mount Shasta itself during the month of May 2019, but the Mount Shasta area saw an interesting increase in seismicity this month, but not too crazy. Now, at first glance, this appears to be a normal high-frequency volcano tectonic earthquake. However, look at the spectrogram here, guys. Look at this. Weaker frequencies barely surpass 16 hertz at all, which is somewhat odd for a high-frequency earthquake. Looking at the spectra plot down at the bottom, we see this also cannot be labeled a low-frequency earthquake, seeing there is still some good power up to 15 to 16 hertz. If there was such a thing as a mid-frequency earthquake, which there is not, this would fit the bill. So this one is a little odd. Regardless, let's move on to Lassen Peak, the final volcano in this update. And here we are at the last volcano in the update, Lassen Peak in Northern California. This is a volcano which resides in Northern California, just 60 miles southeast of Mount Shasta. It last erupted in 1915, is the only other volcano in the continental United States to erupt during the 20th century, and is still considered to be highly active. Future volcanic eruptions are very, very probable, seeing there are still many, many active geothermal features that suggest that there still is magma underneath this area. For the month of May 2019, there were 15 reported earthquakes for the Lassen Peak area, which is higher than last month's total of 8. It seems about half of the events occurred under the Lassen Volcanic Center. Here, let me turn on terrain real quick. Under the Lassen Volcanic Center itself, with a few spread to the south and to the southeast, and one little lonely guy far to the northwest. The largest reported event was a magnitude 1.4 earthquake at 4.2 kilometers in depth under Lassen Peak on May 29, 2019 at 2238 UTC. And here the seismogram, spectrogram, spectra plots of the largest event to occur under Lassen Peak Volcanic Center for the month of May 2019. This earthquake contains high frequencies typical of normal volcano tectonic earthquakes, which occur as part of normal background seismicity for volcanoes worldwide. You can see it peaked between 10 hertz and 14 hertz. Very strange. Most earthquakes we see usually have some stronger low frequencies somewhat, but this one's still considered a high frequency volcano tectonic earthquake because it occurred right under the volcano itself. Remember, volcano tectonic earthquakes can be caused by either volcanic processes, hydrothermal processes, or even tectonic processes. So pretty much they're any type of high-frequency earthquake under any volcanic area. And here we are back at the wonderful Upper Geyser Basin with a spider crawling on the webcam. Ah! Oh my goodness! I don't know why the detail is so bad on this camera right now. Hopefully they fix it. I do not know why it's like that. Usually it's not that blurry. But again, we're back at the wonderful Upper Geyser Basin, home to the infamous Old Faithful Geyser at Yellowstone National Park and Caldera. So it seems, of course, that Yellowstone and Long Valley supervolcanoes have the highest seismicity counts out of all the volcanoes that they showed for the month of May 2019. Cascade volcanoes, especially Mount Shasta and Mount Hood, seem to be breaking the pattern of diminishing seismic activity every month. Of course, concerning activity at any of these volcanoes will warrant its own video and its own blog post on my website, especially if increased deformation is spotted in conjunction with increased seismicity, almost a sure sign a magma chamber is growing restless for an approaching eruption or major intrusion event. For those who watch my videos, please go check out my website. My site is helpful in conjunction with my YouTube videos, and it already contains a lot of pages with over 1,000 seismic plots generated by yours truly for many different events and many different volcanoes. I will also be able to upload more information on there than if I were only making YouTube videos. So, if you like, please go check it out. The link to it is below my email address in the description box below. The next monthly update will be for June 2019, which will be uploaded a few days after the month has ended. However, please keep in mind, all updates from here on out are not guaranteed. My life is getting busier, and there are some major things that I need to get figured out, including my future career. If any mistakes have occurred, or I'm wrong about something, please feel free to let me know. I am a chill guy that is actually okay with constructive criticism. Sadly, the world, and especially YouTube, has way too big of an ego right now to think constructive criticism is even a good thing, especially many specific YouTubers. Therefore, I rarely watch YouTube videos anymore, except for a few select videos when I have the time. Don't forget to check out the NW Geology Guy and Morning Dew, two channels with links in the description box below. I will always stand for the truth, no matter where it leads. Why? Because the truth is often considered hate or fear to those who hate or fear the truth. And that is the truth. God bless. Please stay safe and let me know what you think. Ben Ferraiuolo, signing off.